let me now present introduce Agata Lapedriza. She's professor at Universitat Oberta de Catalunya, and she's also a visiting researcher at MIT since 2012. Her research interests are basically on scene understanding and affective computing. And he did the PhD in computer vision in Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona and the degree in mathematics in the Universitat de Barcelona. Thanks, Agata.
Thank you. Okay, so following the last part of the presentation of Francesc, I'm going to talk a little bit more about emotions. So the idea of this project is when we look at an image like this one, we can recognize a lot of emotional information in this image. We can see how this person is showing affection towards her dog. We can see that she seems to be relaxed, so she's lying on the floor, probably in her apartment. So overall, it's like she's showing a pleasant emotion. And we don't need more information to understand that, but just the image that we see. So we have this capacity of recognizing others' emotions very easily, and this capacity is very useful for us for many things. In particular, it's very important for our social interactions. We use this capacity a lot to understand how others feel and to address to other people properly. We use this capacity also for detecting other people's needs or for predicting how they are going to react. So this capacity is extremely useful when we interact with people. We might think that machines that need to interact with people should benefit a lot of having also this capacity of understanding emotions of persons. And from a computer vision perspective, which is the field I work on, this has been approached for a long time, so there has been a lot of people working in emotion recognition, and the typical approach is analyze facial expression. And there's a large community working on that. They had been doing a pretty good job in the last years, and nowadays we have some commercial software already available that can recognize facial expressions very well, can detect the faces, can detect key points of the face, can analyze the configuration of these key points, and can correlate this configuration of your face with some emotions. And they work pretty well, but they have some weaknesses as well. So for instance, when you run this kind of software in an image like this one, you can get this information, so you detect, the software can detect very well the face of this woman here and all of the key points, and it reports that the recognized emotion was happiness in this case. It recognized a smile with a high accuracy, 99% of accuracy, and attention as well, 54% accuracy, which is really good. But unfortunately, the software did not recognize anything for this man. And the reason is that this man is not in a frontal view, it's in a profile view, so there's a lot of information that is missing, and the software is not that robust when there is information that is missing in recognizing emotions. So some risks of using just facial expression for recognizing emotions is like non-frontal faces or partial occlusions. There are other potential problems here when you use just faces for recognizing emotions. Like in this case, for instance, we see this kid, we see clearly there's a facial expression here. We can run again the same software and we are gonna get surprised, and it's very certain the system that the mouth is open, which is pretty good. So it seems reasonable, but the thing is when we see the whole situation of the kid, this facial expression that he's showing has nothing to do with the emotion, but with the action that he's performing. So how can you separate whether the facial expression has to do with the action or with the emotion if you don't see the contextual situation of this person? It's impossible. And there's another problem, which is probably the most challenging one, which is the difficulty in giving emotional meaning to an isolated facial expression. We never see faces isolated like this in our lives. If I show you this expression and if I ask you what's the emotion shown by this person, by this face, it's anger, contempt, disgust, fear. I'm sure we will not agree here. There will be different opinions because it's a very hard problem. However, if I give you more contextual information now, well, we might agree that he's showing disgust probably, right? So now we have some extra information, which is the contextual information, which is congruent with the facial expression because it's actually a facial expression showing disgust. But if I change the context, what happens? So now you recognize something different because the facial expression of disgust and anger are really close. And now the context is not congruent anymore with the disgust, so you recognize anger, and most people recognize this anger, actually. So these are studies, so these are illusions that were created by Khalil Abizif and his team of researchers. They are psychologists that they were studying how the context can influence the way you perceive emotions. And there are other studies in psychology that support this idea that the context is really, really important in order to understand correctly the emotions that people are showing maybe with their faces. So, what's the idea of this project that I'm presenting? We want to recognize apparent emotional states of people, and we don't want to rely just on the information of the face. We want to use also the information of the context. And one of the benefits of using the context is that you can understand some more detailed information about the emotion that this person is feeling, because you can put yourself into this person's situation and think, how would you feel in that case? So for instance, if you look at the situation of this person, you can recognize confidence in the sense of feeling of being certain. In this case, it's proud, so it's part of the definition of confidence here. But this is something that you cannot recognize just from the face. So this is the idea of this project. We have images of people doing different things, different situations, and we want to recognize emotional information that is related with whatever they are doing in this case. And we want to analyze the whole image, so we can go farther beyond of basic emotions. We can recognize emotions like anticipation in the sense of a state of looking forward, or excitement, or so this person is doing something that it's stimulated or energetic, or engagement, so for sure he's paying attention to whatever he's doing, otherwise he would be on the floor. And what's the idea? So here we are approaching emotion recognition, not from facial expression analysis, but from a scene understanding perspective, so from the whole situation. So we are going to use the approaches that are being successful nowadays for scene understanding, which are deep learning models. And the first problem that we face is that we don't have training data for solving this problem, so we would need training data, which is people doing different things, different situations, and the emotions that these people seem to be showing. So we created a data set. We were collecting images. Some of them were manually downloaded from search engines like Google using queries containing emotions, words of emotions. Some of the images also come from public data sets like MS Coco or AD20K. And we needed to annotate these images, so we created this annotations interface where the annotators can see one image and can select what are the emotions that they think these people are showing in these images. We have 26 different categories of emotions, and we are also collecting other emotional information like the continuous dimensions, valence, arousal, and dominance. So valence is a dimension, an emotional dimension that measures whether someone is feeling something unpleasant or negative or something positive or pleasant. Arousal is measuring whether someone is calm or it's agitated and ready to act. Or dominance that measures whether the person feels that is controlled by the situation or is in control of the situation. And we also collected some demographics of the people that are in our data set. For that, of course, we used crowdsourcing. We used Amazon Mechanical Turk platform. And we came with what we call the emotic database, which is a database containing 23,000 annotated images, 34,000 annotated people. So some images contain different people that are annotated with emotions. And we use this emotic data set to train our deep learning model. This is a representation. So this is just our baseline. We have a baseline model for this problem of recognizing emotions in context. This model has two separate modules for extracting features. One is focused on analyzing the person features, so it just processes the window of the image containing the person. And the other one, it's processing the whole image and extracts what we call the contextual information, the context features. And then we merge these features. We have one fully connected, and we have a loss function that combines the estimation of the emotion categories and also of the continuous dimensions. And of course, this model is too big for being trained from scratch with our data set, so we use pre-training. In the case of the person features, we use ImageNet and database for pre-training because ImageNet is an object-centric database and person is one of the objects of ImageNet. And then for the contextual features, we use Places database because Places is a scene-centric database. And for extracting contextual features, we want to process the whole situation or the whole image. Very quickly about the loss function that we use. So for the discrete categories, we are using mean square errors in all the cases. So this is the loss function for the discrete categories, and we have here one weight that is controlling, is balancing the data according to the amount of images that you have per category. Because one of the characteristics of our data set is that it's very unbalanced. For some categories, you have just a few images, and for some categories, you have a lot of images. So if you don't control this during your training, you would never learn those categories that you don't have many positive examples for it. Then continuous dimension, so the same, it's mean square error. And in this case, we have a parameter, so a weight that is controlling a margin. So as the model can do a prediction that it's close enough to the true output, then you don't backpropagate the error. So it's if on the other side the prediction is too far away from the true output, then you backpropagate the error. And this is the final loss that we have, which is a linear combination of these two losses. And I'm going to show you now some results of the method. So these are some predictions. In this case, the method recognizes anticipation, engagement, excitement, and confidence. This would be very challenging if you just look at the face, so you really need to look at the whole situation of the person. Here, pleasure, happiness, affection. This is also very challenging. It's a baby. It's very challenging to deal with emotions of baby, but I think that the system really is capturing the whole situation. Another very challenging result where the person is seen from the back, so you don't see the face. You can see she is probably smiling. The situation just seems to be like a happy situation of a couple having a good romantic moment. Here another example. So in this case, pleasure, affection, happiness, which is reasonable. But unfortunately, when you run the algorithm for the other person, the system like recognizes all the possible emotions. It's clearly confused. But this example is nice because it shows that the system is not just relying on the contextual information, it's also using information of the people that you say that you want to recognize the emotions from. And well, here, if you want more information about this project, we have the data set available. We have our CBPR paper of last year also available, where you can see a lot of statistics on the data set and some quantitative results. And this is a joint work with my student Verona Costi and my collaborator